now. Availability, accessibility, affordability of services for the urban poor and the rural totally lacking. We've got the district and national mental health program, but it hasn't reached these remote areas, nor even the urban poor. We need that very badly. Stigma removal is a very, very important issue. Just like leprosy, this stigma will never go, or must go, but so far we've had. But I must say it is better, because when I first started, I used to see patients. After sometimes spontaneous recovery occurs, and say the girl's marriage is fixed. The father would come and give me an invitation. Doctor, here's an invitation for you for this marriage, but please don't come. That was the end, because I knew I was not going to go. But anyway, that was the thing, because if I went there, how do you know her? I've seen many people asking, if I met a person at any social functions, how do you know Dr. Sarada Menon? Those days, I was very few psychiatrists were there. So they knew that I was a psychiatrist. How do you know her? Knowing her means that you're mentally ill. So that was the feeling. So these important things. Next is training of doctors. Are you aware that today the MBBS person can pass the MBBS without knowing anything of psychiatry? Anything. It is not taught in the undergraduate level. We are fighting, the Indian Psychiatric Society is fighting for this, asking the MCI, Medical Council of India, to change the syllabus so that we can include more psychiatry. Psychiatry is not an examination subject. So why study? Why pass psychiatry? I can get my MBBS without doing psychiatry. That's the situation. Therefore, that same tendency is infectious, and even the general medical practitioners, even our own professionals, are not very much interested in their interest in psychiatry, but not in the last leg of treatment. So I have been asking our society, everybody, to encourage, to stimulate the MCI to change the syllabus to include psychiatry as an examination subject, so that when they pass out, they know something, that there is no health without mental health. They will understand that. Even the postgraduates need regular courses to update themselves on this subject. Now, what is the tragedy today? Main tragedy, apart from what I've told you, is that the concept, the last leg of treatment, is rehabilitation. The concept, practice, research into rehabilitation is almost absent. I'll give you an example. What is rehabilitation? You treat the patient during the acute phase like in any other illness. He recovers from that phase. But then, after that, he has to get back to where he was before he fell ill. Take a person with a fracture. He's in bed for 6 months. Then he becomes better. Then he goes for physiotherapy. He goes for all kinds of things, artificial limbs, all these things. And he gets much better. And he goes back to work. And if nobody does anything, he asks for help. He asks, he wants to improve. He wants to go and work and be a useful citizen. But not so the mentally ill. When they are ill, they are acutely ill, they have a lot of disturbing symptoms, disturbing behavior. But after we treat them, they become quiet, manageable, able to look after themselves, but absolutely no motivation, no interest in anything, in family, in themselves. They will just eat, sleep, and sit doing nothing. And if you ask the family, they'll say, Somberthanam. That's what they think. That's why he's not working. He's lazy. But they don't know. He's not lazy. He cannot. He's not able to do. Just like your bone is gone, something else is gone in the brain. and he cannot do it. That's why he's late. It's for us to find out what is wrong and then remedy. That is the biggest tragedy today, lack of interest. See, I'll give you an example. Supposing you go to a tailor, take a big bit of cloth and say, I want two or three shirts with this. Here is the size, all these things. Please do it for me. He'll be very willing. But take an old shirt. Tell him, this is fraying in the collar, this thing. Can you change it? Yeah, ma. Pudusu vaangalame. That's what he's going to tell you. He doesn't like any kind of repair work. Same thing here. Patient has been ill. He has lost all the skills he had before he fell ill. We have got to see that he gets them back. It's like repairing. So that nobody likes. They're interested in new technology, new measures, what shall I mean, imaging, this, that, so many things, studying genome, studying that, everything. But the man who's suffering, not they're not bothered. He won't come. He won't listen to us. There's the little child who refuses to go to school, who refuses to eat, asking us to make him eat, asking us to send him to school. No, we have to work on them and get them to do it. That is what we have to do with the persons who have had mental illness. Very, very important. The tragedy of the situation is there are a number of persons who have recovered from their symptoms, but they are not able to function. And what is their age? Anything between 20 and 20 after above. So imagine being disabled at 20 years. That is what happens to these people. And if we leave them, what about their family also? One extra mouth to feed, hanging around doing nothing, irritates the family also. So that is a major tragedy nowadays. And why is it that we are not? Because we say they can't understand, they don't do. Ladies and gentlemen, compassion and kindness are languages which the deaf can hear, the blind can see, and the mentally ill can understand. If you know what tool to use to get the patient to understand you, you will succeed. But if you want to have that tool, you want to succeed, you want to do something, you want to feel for the patient, you want to help him and his family, unless you feel, you can't try to think, find out from others, read who's doing what, can I learn from somewhere else, and do that thing with your own patient. That is sorely lacking. And what happens when you look at a mentally ill patient? What's his appearance during the acute illness? Repulsive. He's very when he's chronic, dull, uninterested, no response, no social cognition. So why do you want to go there? So I say, like the great bard, things base and vile, holding no quantity, love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eyes, but with the mind, and therefore is winged Cupid painted blind. So look at the person, not his face, his hair, his dress. Look at him as a human being, then everything will change. Kindness, compassion, love. Mother Teresa, love. That's what she gave everybody. That is her key factor in her success with patients. So I want to just tell you, if Anne Sullivan could get across to Helen Keller, why can't we get across to the mental patient? Because we don't want to. Because they don't look, we cannot appreciate them. We depreciate, even we make them worse than they really are. That's the thing. Ladies and gentlemen, these few, I must tell you this, I was also very concerned with women patients. I gave you the example of a 16-year-old girl. So in the mental hospital, we had women, 20-25, who had illness, recovered from the symptoms, disabled, not doing anything, and cannot be sent home because their families have written them off. So what shall I do with these persons? So I went to the YWCA. I requested them to take a few of my patients, keep them with you, see what you can do with them, help them, feed them, they behave well. They are not violent or anything. So they agreed and had a small two-bedroom apartment. And they took these patients. They were feeding them, clothing them, looking after them, all free. A social worker, again, a social worker from my hospital, will go there, visit the patient once a week, give the necessary medicines, talk to them, etc. If there's the slightest chance of a relapse, she would bring them home to the hospital again until the person is okay and send them back. That two-bedroom apartment is now a two-story building in the YWCA called Navajivan, where women staying there, recovered persons, they stay there. Some of them who have no homes stay there and go for work during the day. They are trained in various crafts, typewriting, computers, tailoring, so many things like that. They find work and sometimes they are even successful. The YWCA social workers are able to find their addresses and even send them home. So, and the other agency that helped me was Madras Seva Sadan. They also took our patients and helped them. So that's the way I was treating the women patients. Even before all this, when I was sitting in my clinic, the parents will come and say, "Amma, I cannot keep this person at home. He's broken our TV, broken our this, everything, I can't. Okay, send them to me." I took up a small house given by my friends, kept the persons there. I didn't have any crafts or anything to give them. So made them do the work in the house. The men were cleaning the garden and all. The women were cleaning the house. Mavatradu, everything, all these to do their own cooking, everything. With the result, they came much better. They came with occupation, with encouragement, with kindness, with compassion. They became better. And I was able to send them home. Number of patients we have treated in this manner also. We call them halfway homes, halfway between the hospital and the home. So, as I said, kindness and compassion, love. That is one thing that is necessary. You put everything, everything that you do, a touch, a smile, a gaze, whatever you do, do it with a smile. Do it with kindness. You may not know technology, you know, of all these things. You may not know the details of all the chemicals that you're giving the patient. But if you do what you can with kindness, the result is wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate the IDF for its humanitarian concerns. I've always felt the same for these people. Thank you very much for listening to me so long. And I'm very grateful for all that you've done.